Get going.
Do you want me to drop this blind? Is that a bit glary?
From my side, yeah.
That is from your side. Please, thank you. That's all right, sunshine. There we go. Now pretend it doesn't exist, because then we won't be worried about wanting to get outside into the... Right. Okay, so last class. So tonight we're going to look at health and safety, but before we do that, just to reflect on what we covered last week. Can you remember anything from what we did last week?
Nothing, because I haven't watched it.
You haven't watched it yet?
No.
Okay. So we were carried on last week with our pay, remuneration systems, types of pay. So we looked at how to sort of set up a bit of a remuneration structure, and we talked about job evaluation, didn't we? Yep, so there were two main types of job evaluation. Can you remember what they were at the moment?
Job evaluation.
They're figuring out.
Analytical and non-analytical, yeah. Job evaluation is about sizing the job. So it's different to job analysis that we looked at earlier, which is finding out about the job. This is about looking at how big the job is. So we usually do that via an analytical process of factor analysis. So we will break down the sort of key four or five factors that are relevant for the organisation, and then allocate points to each job in relation to those factors. Okay. So the points rating system would give us an overall indicator of how many points each job accumulates through that factor analysis, would indicate the size of that job, which gives us an idea of how much it should be remunerated. And that is our method of determining our internal relativity. That's another key concept for pay, that our pay is internally, fair and equitable between different types of jobs, different job sizes, different levels of responsibilities. Okay. And then, so we talked about those different types of job evaluation and setting up and just making that strategic decision for the organisation as to whether it's going to be a pay leader or a pay follower or pay market rates. Hello. I'm not sure if you're going to read it.
I'm here.
Now tell me if it gets too warm. I did have the aircon on.
Yeah. Yeah. But that's okay, I'll just come out.
Yeah, that's alright. I'll turn it on for a little bit and then tell me if it gets too cold. And I'll go just change the temperature. Set it so it's not quite so freezing. So they have to make that decision as to whether you become a pay leader, and so that's looking at the market comparability. So that, those two key concepts of internal relativity and market comparability, and determining what you can pay for each job. Okay. Just reviewing a little bit from last week. We haven't missed much. Mm-hmm. We also talked about different policies around progression, so making sure that there's a really clear, transparent progression policy in place as to how people increment up the pay scale. So whether or not we use an automatic system or it's discretionary. If it's discretionary, it means somebody's making a decision. So what sort of decision framework do you have in place? Do you have a committee or do you have what sort of process is there? How many forms do you have? There's usually, to make it a more objective process, you need to have some structure in place around how we make those decisions. Okay. And we looked at the types of pay and pay systems, so just having a base pay, some wages and salary, and then their variable pay options. Did anyone get a chance to read that handout on why incentive plans cannot work? No?
I read the first page.
Oh yeah, you read the first page. That's a good start. Right. Thinking about do we link pay to performance? If we or the type of work that you're doing is variable pay, so paying for output or for you know quantity produced, is that, or quantity sold or whatever, is that an appropriate payment structure for this type of job? You know, so sales positions often have that high component of variable pay. You know, real estate agents, you know, a large proportion is variable pay depending on how much they sell. But they've always had that base pay.
I know some travelling reps that used to come to the farm on their saying they had a salary, but if they got sales, yeah.
Got a lot more.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, you know, it's hard to pay just on output because then if you don't, you know, sell anything that week, you get nothing. So, you know, it's hard to attract people who might, you know, you might be able to attract young people for those sorts of jobs who don't rely on that. Stability of income quite so much, but once you've got family and a mortgage and things, you actually need that guaranteed income. So that's why having some base pay and a variable component is relevant in those jobs. So and we just talked also about allowances and benefits. So you know, having different allowances for perhaps a uniform allowance that you can spend money on, or a travel allowance if you're doing a lot of travel for the job. And also about a market allowance, so paying a higher rate for a job that where you need to be able to recruit somebody from industry and can't, you know, the internal pay rate wouldn't be sufficient for that. So you can pay that as an allowance, or a higher duties allowance if you're acting up in a higher level position and take on additional responsibilities. And benefits, so our all of the other benefits that we get from working in the organisation. So, you know, your KiwiSaver or your life insurance reductions or discounts at various places.
Is it Red Cross Medical Cover?
Yeah, Red Cross Medical Cover. Yeah, ours is Southern Cross or something.
Yeah, Southern Cross.
Yeah,
whatever.
Red Cross. Generally something like that. You know, even those, you know, like if you get a discount on meals, if you're, you know, if you're working in the hospitality.
Those are laundry allowances. That's a uniform. Yeah, got to take care of.
Yeah, good. Exactly. So there are all sorts of things that sort of you might be familiar with from different jobs that you've held, but, you know, sort of goes into that whole process of how do we as an organisation design that overall remuneration package? You've got to think of all of those aspects as a part of it. You know, it's not just the wages that you're taking home. Okay, so hopefully you've got enough there to carry on with that assignment for pay and remuneration. And we'll give you another assignment for tonight on workplace safety and health. So this one is obviously quite a topical one. We're going to look at being able to apply an understanding of current legislative requirements for health and safety in the workplace to a given situation. So we'll look at what are the responsibilities, a little bit about hazard identification and notification, accident reporting, investigation, and induction and training. Now, health and safety is huge. We're doing a little bit in 2 hours with 15% of a 20 credit paper. Okay, so we're just going to like skim it. These guys here, this class that have been in here today, doing a whole unit standard just on inspecting, reporting and reviewing plans. And I guess they've probably been here all day, and they'll probably be here all day tomorrow as well by the looks of it. So, you know, that's just one aspect of health and safety. Okay, so you can go into this in a lot more depth, obviously. And I'm sure some of you probably are familiar with it in quite a lot more depth.
Yeah.
Working on a dairy farm?
Yeah.
Yeah. What about you, Jemima? Any much experience with health and safety requirements in your role? Probably had a wee health and safety induction at the very beginning, did you?
I can't remember.
You can't remember? All right. Obviously it was important and successful. Joanne?
Then we had an induction. And I'm actually part of the team of work.
Health and safety committee?
Yeah.
Good. Right. Okay, obviously, this is a topic that comes everybody, every workplace, every industry. So we're talking such huge diversity in work and the types of work that people do. There is a basic assumption that, you know, we don't go to work to get hurt or to hurt other people. So unfortunately, we do live in a world where actually that does happen. You know, with all those best of intentions, if nobody's intending to hurt other people and or themselves, then surely the goal of zero harm is something that is achievable. So they talk about this term zero harm being, you know, a target with, of zero, where no accidents, no injuries are occurring in the workplace. So is that achievable, do you think?
But then there's human error. There always has been.
There's always going to be human error.
It's up to the individual.
Yeah.
Whether they look after themselves and all other people.
Yeah. Human error.
How conscious of them.
We make mistakes, absolutely. We can have the best of intentions in the world.
The best of intentions and the best of everything, but accidents do still happen.
Accidents do still happen.
You can minimise it, but
yep.
We can't absolutely eliminate it.
We can't, we're never going to stop them from completely happening.
Yeah.
But we can minimise the potential consequences of the outcome. It would be, you know, in an ideal world, we should be able to achieve zero harm. And, you know, a lot of organisations have made some really good progress in terms of bringing down their incident and injury rates. Overall, each year in New Zealand, you know, we have some pretty horrible statistics. And it's actually, you know, we've got one of the highest work-related fatalities out of Canada, Ireland, Australia, and the UK. You know, so we're quite up there in terms of some of those other developed countries that we compare ourselves to as well.
Is it the she'll be right attitude?
The she'll be right attitude, maybe.
Well, we can do it. You know, like it's, they just have a can-do attitude.
Yeah.
You know, they don't take it in this, well, when Dara coming in, you know, history, nobody's like, oh no, I'm going to do that, that's not safe. No, just, oh, we've got to do it, we'll just deal with it.
Yeah, get in a professional when you can do it yourself.
Yeah, this doesn't matter that the track is
here. Let's give it a crack and see what happens, shall we? Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. So, yeah, that is that sort of typical Kiwi can-do attitude. You know, we can fix it with a piece of number 8-1. Is it safe to fix it with a piece of number 8-1? Probably not. You know, so yeah, we've got some pretty poor statistics, and that's why there's been such a strong emphasis on it, this and the change in the legislation that has evolved, which we'll talk about shortly. Just remembering though that when you talk at actual accident and injury rates, those are the tip of the iceberg in terms of what's actually happening out there. And think about all the times where something almost happened but didn't. You know, I'm sure we've all been in that situation, almost slip over. You know, like, so but those are the, you know, for every fatality, there's potentially 300,000 at-risk behaviours happening. And it's just that one person got really unlucky. Okay? So I think it's those 300,000 at-risk behaviours that lead to those 600 incidents in the overall number of accidents that we've sort of really got to pin down. And that's when we've got to look at changing culture in the organisation. Okay? If it's that culture to take those at-risk behaviours, then we're not going to change those overall high-level statistics. Those are old, that's old data, but it still gives you an idea of the fact that it's the tip of the iceberg. Sorry, I mentioned the legislation. So we did have the Health and Safety in Employment Act 1992 and an Amendment Act in 2002. And now the current one is our Health and Safety at Work Act, which came in, which was 2015, came in last year. But why do you think they changed the name of that one from Health and Safety and Employment to Health and Safety at Work?
Is
Because of the mental side of it as well. Is that why they moved it up? That's in debate at the moment, isn't it?
Well, stress and bullying and things were under the Health and Safety and Employment Amendment Act. They came in then. So that was covered at that point under that legislation. But yeah, you've got it on here, Janice, with the Health and Safety and Work Act covers all aspects of work, whereas employment is very specific to the employee-employer relationship, and that doesn't include contractors. And what, you know, the issue at Pike River obviously brought up hugely was the fact that actually there are contractors on the work site as well who aren't employed by the employer. What are the obligations of
that's because they are not employed, they're self-employed contractors, so if they're not covered by the Employment Act, then
they might be covered by, they're working for a different company that's contracted into a specific site. So we have to think of it as broader than just the employee-employer relationship. It has to be about overall work.
Every person in the group.
Yes. So everyone's responsible. So, just regardless, you can't say, it's not our company, this is not our work site, we're just coming in to
it's
do
not
the
our division.
Wiring. Yeah.
That's the same with the Westland Dairy Company.
Yeah.
So anybody that goes on there is inducted into the workplace and has like codes or they're allowed to go on the yellow lines, not the red lines, and all of that because they're all subcontractors.
Exactly. So we're still responsible for subcontractors if they're on our work site. That's the ultimate outcome of this change in our legislation. There's also Hazardous Substances and New Organisms Act is relevant, so that's where we look at, the hazardous, chemicals and things that could be harmful, so asbestos or working with anything that's potentially harmful or impacting on health. So it's not just the accidents that we're talking about where we hurt somebody, we're talking about long-term health consequences for people as well.
You know, that covers like anybody that works in hospital. Exposed to
blood and diseases,
working with animals, so they're exposed to diseases.
And then obviously the other relevant legislation is our Injury Prevention, Rehabilitation and Compensation Act. So that's the one that gives us the framework for ACC and the no blame approach to getting somebody rehabilitated and back to work and sort of providing them the financial support to do so, which we'll look at shortly as well. So, there's lots, it's not just about the overall harm that we're causing people, there's flow-on effects of that harm. There's the effects for families, effects for welfare, effect on there's costs involved with every incident or accident that happens in a workplace. You've got actual sort of long-term costs that occur. Have a look at the ACC injury cost calculator. First aid, transportation, loss of productivity, first aid supplies, equipment, ambulance, taxi. They're looking at $4,950 just for the incident, and then it has an investigation on top of that. So the time involved in investigating. Then there are replacement costs, so if you hire somebody to replace that person, or there might be costs involved in that, and then loss of productivity, work time, disruption to the workplace. Some of those things are hard to measure, okay? So that's why I say that they might come across as sort of hidden costs with that. And if you total that all up, there's $9,000 there, just for a simple slip on a wet floor, okay, which could have been prevented. So what you can do with that injury cost calculator actually is go in and enter your own organisation's information for an accident and calculate the cost. So
that could have been me a few weeks ago. I went down on the wet floor in the kitchen, and I was bruised to buggery, but I was not hurt at all.
No.
I was just lucky.
That is very lucky. Very lucky. Sometimes it is just luck. Have you still called an ACC form just in case it comes back later on?
Oh, an incident report.
Yeah.
And I offered to send photos of the bruises to my restaurant manager, and she declined.
Personnel for 2 years before he's got his current full-time job, and just what they go through, and they have health and safety meetings, they do everything properly.
Yeah.
Another West Coast here is like, oh yeah, we're going to do health and safety, so on that, and head over there and do some work.
Well, I'm blaming myself because of the shoes that I was wearing, but the general manager was like, why are they even mopping the floor at that hour of the night, and I was like, oopsie, just got someone in trouble here.
Yeah, but that's, they would like do an incident report, work out why it was doing like that, was there signage around, did you see the signs, did you, what shoes were you wearing, and what, nothing bad would happen, it would just be like, well, perhaps you need to have different shoes and different signs, so just make
policy changes as a result of something that
could have been. And he worked in a factory. And they come around and check that you weren't tired after 4 hours of your shift. If you were tired, you got a rest break.
Nice.
Yeah. And their tests, totally dumbfounded that they actually did that.
That's great. Yeah, no, it's good. They're taking it seriously. And that's organisations are actually not, morally, socially, but also legally obligated to take it seriously. And it is a cultural attitude shift, and maybe we're behind the times on the West Coast. But I think there's real progress, happening. There's the West Coast Health and Safety Forum, which has been established.
Yeah.
So it's a group that meets every 6 weeks where people come along and, maybe HR managers or health and safety representatives or health and safety managers, anybody from an organisation, I go to them, just because I'm interested, but to go and learn about issues around health and safety. And I think
sometimes
I'm starting to
shift the little things.
Yeah, that's right. I'm starting to see a bit of a shift because I'm starting to realise that actually the consequences of not complying are going to be huge if they get caught out with these things. We want to lower the cost of illness and injury. We want to be an employer of choice, a good place to work. If you're seen as a risky place to work, then people are think, well, why would I go work there? So, it's actually about creating an organisation that people want to work in. And obviously, organisations will pay ACC levies based on the number of incidents and accidents that they have and injuries in their workplace. So it's in their own interest financially as well to keep those accidents down, because they'll pay lower ACC levies as a result. So we have a video here of Health and Safety NZ aluminium smelter, which is an old video, but it sort of gets the idea across around some of the issues that are relevant. But you may want to plug this into the sound and you have a look at the activity one for some focus questions.
ANZUS was performing quite badly across the board. Our safety record in the past probably was pretty consistent with the rest of manufacturing industry.
Focus was pretty much on the old Kiwi edge, get in, show up at a Kiwi ingenuity and get it done. Unfortunately, the results in terms of safety performance reflected that we didn't have a high emphasis on safety at that time.
Things are quite different now. I mean, maybe one person per year that can't come to work in an ex-rostered shift, but things have changed quite a lot.
Although we did achieve that, it wasn't good enough. We've got a goal of zero, and everybody's going pretty hard out to ensure we can satisfy that goal.
We believe that the goal of zero workplace injuries and illness is possible. We've seen it in other industries, and we know that we can get there. ANZUS produces around 340,000 tonnes of aluminium product per year, and we employ about 780 people, plus another 160 contractors. It's a great business. Historically, ANZUS has been an organisation that's been run top-down. The Performance Enhancement Program was an opportunity to turn the business upside down and start bringing ideas from the shop floor and getting management to act on those ideas. And we generated over 10,000 ideas, of which 5,000 were fully analysed and over 1,000 ideas implemented. In the 2 years following that, we increased the production, we reduced costs significantly and improved safety to a level that we hadn't seen prior to that.
Very, very willing workforce, buying into the initiatives. We haven't done any work that has been a bolt-on and then discarded. Everything we do for a valid reason. We give it time to embed, and we do it as well as, not instead of.
It is fair to say that the focus at the time was cost and productivity, but because you can't de-link safety and health and environmental performance from productivity and cost, we saw an improvement across the board on all of our key metrics, including safety, including the environment, including communities, as well as cost and profitability.
Yeah, we're meeting every 6 weeks, and we follow up on issues that have come up during the 6 week period. We hope to improve each one.
I said, righto, you tag out the west one only.
They're always looking at different ways to improve their daily jobs.
In fact, we have one idea in particular, the offline reconstruction project, that was a major shift in the way we do business. It was an idea that came off the shop floor, it was highly innovative, and not only did it improve the productivity of our plant, but it improved the safety enormously of that team.
In the old days, we were building online, so we had to work in an environment on the pop lines, competing with the reduction operations. It was a very hot and dusty environment as well. It took us around about 7 days to construct a cell down on that line. So we had to dig a cell out online as well as reline it down there. We used a hazard evaluation analysis tool to actually step through all our, the concept of what we wanted to achieve. Safety underpinned the whole design of that project. But for the guys, we've got a very pleasant environment to work in compared to the online environment.